You're on the air.
Hi.
Yeah.
How's it going?
Okay, thanks for the call.
Oh, wait a second. Listen, I'm from D.C., and I just want to say that Howard Stern is awesome, and I'd love to speak to him.
You're on the air.
We need down here new diners, number one.
New diners?
New diners down here. There are no Greek diners like back in New York. I'm from Long Island. I go to school at American University.
Oh, moron.
But anyway, that guy, not the guy on the phone, but this Doug Trachtenberg, yeah. The Grease Man.
Hello, Grease.
Hey, Grease.
I predict that his life will be in ruin in 6 months.
Well, it's interesting, I'm sure. I don't know for a fact, but I wonder what Goff has him doing on the weekends.
Yeah, like in-store appearances.
Yeah, because we could pretty much ruin those for him.
Yeah, what we'll do is, if people in Washington could send us a list of all of the Grease's itinerary.
Yeah, the Grease activities, if you will.
Yeah, all his little stupid activities that Goff forces him to do. Goff, the general manager, we can ruin that for him. We can just have people go in there and yell my name out
right.
And stuff. And kind of ruin things for him.
It'll be a fun weekend.
Because Goff, when he signs a contract, forces the performer to make one in-store a month. So he's got to go humiliate himself for once a month.
Yeah.
That's a good deal.
So we can fix that.
Yeah, we'll fix that. That makes a lot of sense. Goff, you are the worst, man. You don't even know how to run a radio station. I'm going to teach you the lesson of your life, boy. I'm going to whip you. This is it, pal. It's over. You divorced your wife. You got your little mansion that you built off of my name. Remember when he bought that little... It wasn't even a mansion. It wasn't even nice. He thought it was a mansion. The one with the fountain with the guy peeing in it.
Yeah, Mike Tyson decorates better.
Yeah. Goff buys a house in suburbia on my money, by the way. He wouldn't pay us any money, but he was making $500,000 a year. So he decided to trade upward mobility.
Mm-hmm.
And he got a 5-bedroom nice suburban house, except he left the fountain in with the boy peeing in it in the middle
right
of his hallway.
Right in the front door.
In the front door.
Like, stumble over this thing.
And it wasn't even a big entrance to the house. So like you walk right into a guy peeing, a statue of a little boy peeing into the water.
You get splashed by this boy.
It was like the Liberace story. The little fountains of guys peeing. Like Rock Hudson's decorated the house.
Look at my fountain.
Look at my beautiful fountain. This boy peeing. Young boy peeing. Ah, look at it. No prostate condition, boy. Just look at the water flow out of him. Yes. Yeah, really nice.
And every little nook and cranny. I mean, it wasn't the biggest house in the world.
Right.
So he shoved a bar into a little room.
Yeah.
Everything was cramped.
Yeah, everything was cramped. But he wanted to have, like, he thought it was like the Playboy Mansion.
Yes.
Got rid of the wife. You know.
Oh, yeah.
Big divorce. I hope she took you to the cleaners. But something tells me there's no justice in the world, and she didn't get any money.
I think she got her sanity back.
Yeah.
That's what she got in the divorce.
She didn't know what to do.
Oh, boy.
Pulling the hair out of her head. She didn't know what to do for him, too. I remember she was, like, you know, dyeing her hair red.
I know.
She didn't know what to do
for
him.
Poor baby.
Yeah.
I felt so bad for that woman.
Well, I'll tell you what, Goff, I'm dedicating my first year in Washington to your wife. Because I'm going to do it for her. I'm going to wipe you out, sucker. You're finished. All that money you made, I hope you saved some of it. Hope you didn't spend it too wildly because you're finished in a year you're retiring. I'm bringing your station to its knees. You suck. I'm ready for you now. Because there's one thing that you can't fight, and that's talent. You could pay lots of guys a lot of money, man, just to get back at me, but you are going to fail. We are going to crush you so rapidly, you're not going to know what hit you. We're going to crush you like a cheap beer can. You stupid jerk. I'm here for you. I've waited 5 years for you. You in that stupid dick cheap radio station. Eat me! 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 You're finished. You're finished. I'm all fired up for you. I don't know what to do with myself.
You better go find another tick.
Girl. Yeah. I've never been so motivated in my life to come to work. I've never been so motivated.
So you'll have an excuse for why you look so bad.
You know, I paid Infinity just to come here. They didn't pay me. I'm paying them to allow me to broadcast into Washington. Just so I could get to you. Remember when that tick bit you? That Robin refers to? Remember that Rocky Mountain tick? They didn't know what it was that was killing you? Go out and find a new tick. That was a great.
We're going to be your new tick.
Remember when you used to come hobbling into work as you were dying? Nobody felt bad. We were all praying for your death.
We used to talk about how bad you looked, and it couldn't be much longer now.
You would have no idea what a schmuck people think you are, do you? You have no idea what a schmuck the grease man thinks you are. Everybody in this business laughs at you, but I am laughing the hardest because I'm going to finish your radio station. I'm going to squelch you. I'm going to squash you. I'm going to squash you. You will hobble like when that tick bit you. You will hobble into work, bent over.
I hope you kept that cane.
Yeah. Remember that cane you had when the tick bit you and your wife was caring for you and stuff? I don't know why she just didn't kick you down some steps. I'm going to beat you fair and square, Goffy. I'm coming for you. I'm going to beat you fair and square. All I'm going to do is talk, and that's how I'm going to beat you. All I have to do is open my mouth. You know why? Because God blessed me. He must have blessed you, too, with good luck.
I don't know who blessed him.
Yeah, to keep us out of Washington in 5 years. But now I'm back, and I'm here, and I'm your worst nightmare. And I'm stuck all the way at the end of the dial. We're all the way at 106.7.
We ask for the obstacles.
We're at a station that, you know, arguably has a worse signal than you. People will rather listen to a scratchy Howard Stern and Robin Quivers than a clear grease man. Because he sucks, and I will defeat him. And you suck, and I will defeat you. You moron. You are a moron. And I will beat you. And you can do whatever you want, man. You can do advertising campaigns. You can call all your fancy friends. You can do whatever you want, man.
Scrape together some money and give it away.
That's right. Scrape together as much money. Go to the Benders, your rich construction pals, and ask them for $1 million to give away on the air. Ask them for $5 million to give away during your morning show. And you still won't beat us. Because we are 10 times more compelling than that moron you have on. Trachtenberg. We're here. It's your worst nightmare. What is it, Gary?
Comedian Gilbert Gottfried is on the line.
Oh, he wants to welcome us?
Yes.
All right. Why don't we take a break and then have Gilbert welcome us into Washington? We'll be back right after these words.
94 WYSP is on the verge of an extraordinary event. We're taking 8 brand new luxury import automobiles and giving them away throughout the fall. Your chances to win have never been better. What will it take? Details are coming soon on 94 WYSP, Philadelphia's classic rock and roll.
Live from New York, it's the WYSP Morning Show. Ladies and gentlemen, Howard Stern.
K-Rock at WYSP. I forgot to watch the Liberace story. I could shoot myself.
I only watched a few minutes of it.
Anybody got a tape of it?
I watched about 5 minutes of it where he brought, in the 50s, he brought some guy to one of those hamburger joints.
Yeah.
And seduced him while... It was just so
funny. While what? While you're eating hamburgers?
You're hanging the rack on the side of the car and he's like, I have a job for you. I want you to come and work for me. It was really sick.
He was coming on to the guy?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I got to get a tape of that. Someone please send me a tape of that.
Yeah, the only part I saw was the part where he had bought this girl. He brought this girl home to introduce to his mother because he wanted to get married.
Yeah.
And, you know, the mother sitting there interviewing the girl, and the girl saying, oh, Lee and I have traditional values, and we want to have families. And the girl saying, and you will have grandchildren.
Yeah.
And a day or two later, Lee goes over to ask the father for permission.
Yeah.
And the father says...
And they fall in love.
No, the father's like, he's waxing a car. He's a real man, you know. He's right. Standing there waxing one of his cars.
You know, Dad, would you like me to take your temperature rectally?
And he keeps running around the car. You should see it, because Lee's trying to talk to him. And so he puts a car between them.
Go away, you log lover.
And he finally says, no, I'm sorry, I gotta stop this, because I love my daughter too much.
Yeah.
And he says, but why? How could you do that? He says, well, this is my daughter. I had to look into your background.
Mm.
He says, you know, I just can't subject my daughter to that. He goes, why would you let some embarrassing innuendo ruin our lives together?
Innuendo? The only thing going in your endo. I can just picture him yelling at Liberace and Liberace.
Oh, Jesus. My daughter wants children, and I don't think that'll happen with you.
Well, I know a few young boys.
I'll tell you one thing. The guy who plays Liberace is scarier than the real Liberace. They actually found one guy to look scarier than the real Liberace.
Well, do you know there are two Liberace movies? They found two people to look like Liberace.
If anybody's got a copy of the Liberace story, please send it to me because I missed it and I'm freaking out. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, on our phones, the very famous comedian Gilbert Gottfried.
Yes.
Howard, should I turn my radio down? Should I turn my radio? Can I hear something by Brazil 66 and dedicated to Marie and Yonkers?
Gilbert Gottfried, of course, the brilliant comedy of Gilbert Gottfried. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Washington. Gilbert Gottfried, ladies and gentlemen.
Should I turn my radio down?
Yes, turn...
The minute I feel like I'm on the phone, I feel like there are certain things you have to say.
Yeah, turn your radio down.
How come I hear you a minute later? Should I turn my radio down?
And then say, I'm on the air. And then say,
am I on the air?
Is that me?
Can I talk to Howard?
Can I talk to Howard? You are talking to Howard. No, I want to get on the air with Howard now.
Yes, well, but can I talk to Howard right now?
Yeah.
but am I on the air when I'm talking to Howard?
No, I hear somebody else. He couldn't be talking to me on the air.
But am I talking to Howard then later? They're going to put it on the air?
Right. Hey, did you see the Liberace story?
It was wonderful.
Did you really see it?
No.
Oh.
No, I'm sorry. I had to miss it. But
what'd you do last night?
A lot of big things. A lot of truly big things.
I picture Gilbert sitting at home in his apartment just like... sit around watching TV.
Yeah. I sit around, I have a flashlight, and I get under the blanket, and I work out a good story for myself. I like to work out. You know, I think it's important to work out in a strong storyline.
Yes. Gilbert Gottfried, ladies and gentlemen, welcoming us into Washington. Gilbert, I think at this point it's appropriate for you to tell the audience in Washington just how successful and friendly we've become. And we've become friendly with you, and we have a lot of famous friends. Go ahead, just say a few words.
You know something, Washington? Howard Stern has become very successful and friendly, and he's friendly with me.
Thank you, Gilbert. All right. I want to thank you for welcoming us into Washington.
Yes, I'm welcoming you into Washington. You know, meanwhile, I'm in New York, and I'm welcoming him into Washington. It's like I'm supposed to pretend that I'm in Washington now, saying, oh, welcome to Washington.
Tell him about your new series. Do that.
My new series is the Liberace series.
Gilbert Gottfried as Liberace?
Yes. There's going to be at least 20 different Liberace series. Stories this year.
I heard there was a real cool scene in the Liberace. Jackie said he saw it.
Yes.
That Liberace comes home, I guess, from one of his concert tours.
Uh-huh.
And his mother and, I don't know, somebody else. His sister-in-law?
Yes.
They go, hey, there's a surprise, Lee, up in your room for you. And Lee's like, oh God, yeah. This is like so exciting. Thank you. So he goes up, and his sister-in-law and the mother, I guess, I mean, they couldn't figure out he was gay. You know, they couldn't tell he was slightly effeminate. They had like a hooker waiting for him up in his room, figuring like he'd want to have some.
What a waste of money!
Yeah, figuring he'd want to have some good sex when he got home. You know?
Yeah, they must have thought Lee was shy or something.
They're like,
he didn't know how to talk to a woman.
Well, he hadn't had a woman in a while. And they figure, well, maybe he wants to knock off abroad when he gets home. You know. Just pull down his pants and have a real easy time of it.
Yeah, apparently, from what I understand, that was the whole gist of the story, that mom always was bringing these girls home and finally just resorted to the prostitute.
Right. So he goes up to the room.
But who couldn't tell he had a problem when he's sitting there introducing his fiance? He had a dog in the chair with him.
Yeah, right. Oh, this is my fiance. Hey, seriously, so what happened?
She said that this house, this was a big party.
Yeah.
And his mother and his sister-in-law said, we have something very special up in your room. Somebody wants to meet you. Led him to believe it was like,
oh,
a
young
friend.
Boy.
Yeah. nice-looking
woman. Kenny, is it a 15-year-old boy?
She said she was a fan and tried to kiss him, and he was like, he was as repulsed as, like, one of us would be if we kissed a man.
Well, let's not go that far.
Well,
and that, maybe not all of us.
Oh, but
occasionally I'll kiss a truck driver or something and enjoy it quite a bit.
I think if it was a guy, you know, if it was like Bon Jovi, I don't think I'd mind that.
Well, he freaked out.
He freaked out, so the girl ran up and kissed him.
She tried to embrace him, and then, like, he pushed her away, and he went, came down and said to them, he said, how could you do something like that to me? And, like, it was like at that second, you could tell that they just looked into each other's eyes and said, homo.
Meanwhile, I think Jackie's Liberace impression is incredible.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say that.
Do it again.
How could you do this to me?
I closed my eyes. I thought Lee was in the room with her.
Yeah. How could you do this to me? I mean, it's unbelievable. And then, of course, he looks at the girl and he examines her naked and says, my God, you're hung like a pimple.
But everybody keeps explaining away. Yes, we didn't dwell on the fact that he was gay. Everybody knows
that.
Well,
it was a small portion of
his
life.
Yes.
Yeah, right. It wasn't all-encompassing.
And no one really knows it for a fact.
That's right.
Yeah, it never has been proven, has it?
You know, the fact that he used to dress in sequins and died of AIDS, I mean, that's really funny. These are all moot points.
Well, how far do they get in the story? I mean, is it right up until his death?
Yeah, they each have him dying of AIDS. And in this one, I think the one they had last night, he actually denied that he was dying of AIDS complications. And then at the end, they have a written statement that says, you know.
Because did he ever make
a
written statement?
He died of complications of AIDS.
After he died, he did it.
Right, he wrote something down.
Yeah. I'm going to write from beyond the grave. So, Gilbert, this is it. We're in Washington, Philly, and New York now.
Hi, it's Gilbert Gottfried. You're in Washington, Philly, and New York right now.
All right, and I want to thank you for calling in.
No, it's no problem at all.
All right, man.
It's just really no problem at all. I got to go back to work. I'm doing a Liberace story. Charles Bronson will play Liberace.
All right, Gilbert. We'll see you whenever you come in.
Okay, whenever I come in. Can I shut my radio down?
You can turn it back on after you hang up the phone.
That's all.
Okay.
All right, Gilbert.
Okay.
All right, bye.
Thanks.
Gilbert Gottfried, welcoming us to Washington, yes. Rob. Another friend of the show. What I'm doing is drawing on all the star power we have to, you know, make our first day in Washington special.
Yeah.
Don't expect us the rest of the week.
It's not like this every day.
No. Usually everyone ignores us. You got anybody, I mean, not that Gilbert isn't big. You got anybody big welcoming us?
You have that list I gave you?
Major?
Yeah, there's a national celebrity will be calling.
Jessica Hahn we heard from.
Mm-hmm.
We heard from,
Lewis.
Lewis, Gilbert Gottfried.
We have sports celebrities and big national names.
Let's see, Richard Belzer. Lisa Sliwa.
She'll be calling us from Los Angeles, by the way. She's out in Beverly Hills.
Grandpa Al Lewis.
Who's she harassing out there?
He was tough to get a hold of.
Leslie West.
He was very tough to get a hold of.
Leonard Marshall, the football player. Richard Simmons.
Yes.
Judy Tenuta and Emo Phillips will be calling in to welcome us into Washington. Well, I didn't realize you had those names.
It's interesting, though, that Grandpa is getting a lot of work, you know.
Yeah, from us.
He was in Married to the Mob, wasn't he?
Yeah. Do me a favor. Take Grandpa Al first. Take his call first while he's still alive. Because he's going to go any day
let's
now.
Let's put a rush order.
Anyway, let me get back to my harangue. In Washington, D.C., let me just say this. It wasn't Goff Labar who was a moron or nuts or anything like that. I spoke out of school. I shouldn't say that.
What?
It was me who was a moron forever working for the guy.
Oh, dear.
Because he didn't even want me there. He didn't even want me at the station. And then when I was successful in Washington, he resented my success every step of the way. And for a minute, don't you believe that he didn't?
Oh, no, I know that he did.
I don't mean
in fact, he called it a fluke.
Yeah.
He was one of the first people. We're sitting right there. We're working for him. He called it a fluke.
Yeah. And then he'd tell me every day how we had no competition. That's why we were number one.
Mm-hmm. And then he said that nobody else would hire you, and that's why he didn't have to pay you.
Right. He says, I don't have to pay you. No one else will pay you.
Who else is going to put up with this but me?
Yeah. And believe me, I would have stayed in Washington.
We loved it there.
Yeah, it was great. It was a great environment. So I hope that I finally do get to prove that you are a no-talent general manager. And that you're the fluke. You're Goffla Fluke. Goofla Fluke. Goofla Fluke and his Dick Boy, Grease Man.
Yeah, did you take him into the steam room, Goff?
Yeah, yeah. Let's talk about that when we get back. How Goff, his criteria for hiring people.
Yes.
His criteria, how he hires someone. It's great to be back in Washington. There's a lot of memories I want to dredge up and never let die. Goof La Floof and his dick boy, Grease Boy. We'll see how well you guys do now that you have competition in town. Because Don Geronimo's no kind of competition. He's just a big, fat jerk with no talent whatsoever. Almost used the F word.
Yeah, take it easy, Howard. Yeah.
I forget sometimes. That's why I stick the microphone right in my face where it can actually hit me in the nose.
So, so I remember
we're on the air. I make it you ever notice it scrapes my nose, man? Just to remind me that we're on the air, or else I'll forget. All right, we'll be back right after this word.
The Olympic Games are over, and so is the Eagles' battle with the Oilers. I'm Lou Tilley, and I'll have a report on both of these stories at 4 and 5:30 this afternoon with Ed Shockey on 94 WYSP.
From New York, it's the WYSP Morning Show. Ladies and gentlemen, Howard Stern.
The number to call for Legend, 516-795-9000. You'll like doing business with Legend Porsche Audi Sub Sterling at 158 Merrick Road in Amityville, New York, and Legend Volkswagen, 5775 Merrick Road in Massapequa, New York. Let's do the news.
All right.
One more person wants to welcome us into Washington.
All right, a quick welcome. Mm-hmm. Who is it?
It's Grandpa Al.
Grandpa Al?
Yeah.
Well, we wanted to get to you before you died.
Before I died.
Yeah, I got nervous. I said, you know, we haven't had Grandpa Al on in a while, and there's no way he's going to live much longer.
Listen, you long stream of urine analysis.
Oh, come on.
Now, look.
Try and keep it clean, Grandpa.
Say hello. I try to keep it clean. You're going into Washington, D.C.
Yeah, we'll
try. You're asking me to keep it clean?
You know, I'm trying to class up this show.
By going into Washington, D.C., I mean you're walking into a cesspool.
Uh-oh, here we go. Listen, don't start. What did you... You been hitting the bottle this morning or what?
No, I haven't been hitting the bottle. I have not been hitting the bottle. First of all, it's so nice to talk to you again.
Where are you?
And right now, I'm in the bathroom.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
What I'm state? That's what we were talking about.
I'm at home in the bathroom. What is the matter with you?
State of near hysterics is what he's doing.
What are you talking about? I'm doing some convolution.
Have you ever see, what's his name anymore? Herman Munster?
Yeah, he's up in Maine. He's doing a movie in Maine.
You know what's great to do to him? Fred Gwynn is his name.
Right.
Whenever you see him, just go, hey, Herman Munster.
Oh, he would hate you for that.
Yeah, I mean, the whole theater, I saw him in, that Harlem movie, Apollo,
Cotton
Club.
Yeah.
And everyone in the theater just went, hey, Herman Munster.
Yeah. And they start to laugh.
It's like, hey, it's Herman.
Yeah.
Now, what did he just do recently? He was in another movie.
He's done a zillion pictures. Fatal Attraction.
Fatal Attraction. Everybody
there was another one. Yeah, everyone goes, hey, Herman Munster. And he's only trying to get away from that. Yeah. It's great.
It's terrible.
It's great. It's like, when you see him, just go, hey, Herman Munster.
Okay.
And he'll be like, Lily. Yeah, no, he'll just say, you know, he says, you know, I've done a lot of roles since then.
He does. He does. And
hey, so you're married to the mom?
Yes.
Good
but
job.
You didn't see my video, though.
And you know what everyone did? They went, Grandpa Lewis.
Right. You didn't see the video I did with Debbie Harry, Blondie.
Oh, yeah? What is that all about?
Funny video. Very good. It was related to the film.
How is she? She lost any weight?
Nice lady.
She's a good-looking girl, but she's got to lose about 15 pounds.
She's not a girl anymore.
Yeah, that's right.
She's not a girl anymore.
Well, if Grandma's saying that.
Hey, and how's that youngster you're nailing? How's your girlfriend? You still with her?
They don't leave me, kid.
Oh.
Are you still with her?
They don't leave me.
Grandpa Al Lewis has this young girlfriend.
Yeah.
They don't leave.
And she's cute.
With a smile on her face.
That's right.
And Grandpa Al Lewis is like... It's like an escapee from a geriatric ward. I mean,
listen,
he really is aged.
Listen, kiddo.
Yeah.
Kiddo, you're going to play Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
You've never played Washington, D.C.
Yes, I have. I played there a year and a half.
Where?
Washington, D.C.
Oh, then you were asked to leave.
Well, I was not asked to leave. The guy wouldn't pay me, and then I left. And by the way, I wasn't fired. I mean, technically, I guess you could say I was fired.
You were fired.
I was not.
No.
I had signed with another radio station.
Now, who is that dark mahogany stooge?
Hey.
What is this now?
For all we know, Grandpa, you're a dark mahogany stooge.
Yeah, after all that white makeup, who knows
what is that? All she does is, Howard said, No. Yeah.
Look, you're chasing around Eddie Munster.
Yeah, I see you. I see you, like, trying to get Eddie Munster to open up supermarkets with you. What's he holding up? What is Eddie Munster busy? What did I see you guys? I saw you, Marilyn, and Eddie Munster on TBS.
Right.
The Turner Broadcasting System.
Right.
I guess Ted Turner's new pet project is giving Grandpa work.
Yeah, I think he and Grandpa are hooked up.
And Eddie's sort of embarrassing, but Marilyn has aged. Like, I mean, she looks bad.
Yeah.
No, she's a little heavy.
A little heavy.
A little.
Oh, man.
A little heavy.
She used to be so gorgeous.
She aged more than you, Grandpa.
Yeah. I mean, Grandpa looks like a spring chicken next to Marilyn. Oh, for crying out loud.
Nice
what happened
lady.
To her, man?
She's a nice lady.
She married?
Sun Valley, Idaho. Oh, sure. Got big kids.
Maybe she was out in the sun too long.
Maybe that California sun.
She's very wrinkled.
We're going to play the circus together.
She's in the circus?
No, I'm doing an act, my old act in a circus in Evansville, Indiana in a couple of weeks.
What is your old act?
Baby, you're too young.
What do you mean you're going to be in the circus?
Baby,
Grandpa Al Lewis in the
to go with it, kiddo.
Grandpa Al Lewis will be in the circus?
Right, in Evansville, Indiana, a Shrine Circus in Evansville.
And what do you do when you go to the circus? That laugh sounds like sex with an elephant. All right, Grandpa. Listen, thank you for welcoming us into Washington.
Really, it's a pleasure. And believe it or not, I mean, I have to tell you this. And I know you're going to hate it. But the tens of thousands of people who come into the restaurant and say, when are you going to be on Howard Stern's? When are you going to be on Howard Stern's? You're the only reason I listen to that show. You wake him up. Those other people are... What happened to the joke, man? He died?
Yeah.
Because the show has died.
All right. Goodbye, Grandpa Al.
I love you.
As
love
usual,
you too.
It was
goodbye.
A pleasure.
A pleasure.
I love you.
Right, goodbye. He's such a nut. You know, I had to ban him from the show for a while.
He was getting out of hand.
Yeah, he was getting completely out. Remember the time we thought he made in his pants? Yeah, it was like really funny.
We really thought Grandpa was down for the count.
Yeah, I thought there was something really wrong. We decided to have Grandpa. We were doing this. The FCC had really gotten on my butt, and we decided to hold a rally. But it was a goof. I mean, it wasn't like for real. So we had a rally, and Grandpa Al came in to be at the rally.
Early.
With Lisa Sleewa. He came in early, and he sat down, and he didn't smell too good.
No.
And someone thought he'd made in his pants, and then we put him out in the lobby, and he was just sitting there, and we thought he was sitting in his own excrement.
Yeah, and somebody was like, check his pulse.
We thought he had died. I'm not kidding. And just like, you know, before you die, you go to the bathroom.
Right.
Like your last act.
Somewhere right around the time you go.
Yeah, everything releases.
Yeah.
You have no control anymore. You're dead. And we thought he was dead because he really kind of smelled bad. And then, all of a sudden, we propped him up and put him on the bus. And then he came alive. He got off the bus to the rally.
Yeah.
It was at Dag Hammarskjöld Plaza. Dag Hammarskjöld, isn't that Swedish student who got killed in a homosexual...
No, that was Ejjel Dagvesti.
Oh, Ejjel Dagvesti.
Yeah, Dag Hammarskjöld was a UN General Secretary.
Oh.
Or Secretary General.
Was he a homosexual?
No.
Oh, okay. But anyway... So Grandpa just sat there, and then all of a sudden he got off the bus, and then he started screaming the F word out. Over the air, because he thought that's what the rally was about,
right.
That we wanted to say the F word, because he was completely confused. But he's a good old man, and we should have him back on at some point. But, you know, I could take him periodically.
In small doses.
Small doses. It's good when you can control him over the phone. He was pretty lucid today.
Yeah. That day he was not lucid.
No. Well, he was lucid in his pants, but...
I still haven't figured out what went on there.
I think he made in his pants, and he didn't want to tell anyone.
He should have gone home. If
that was that's what I said.
Why stay around?
Yeah.
Isn't that uncomfortable?
I don't know. He was just having a real bad day. It was his time of the month, and he was having a hard time. Anyways, 8:08. We'll be back right after these words, and we'll get to the news and more guests and Washington phone calls, and we're very excited to be back in Washington today at 92.3 K-Rock, WYSP, and WJFK.
94 WYSP is your key to 101.
And maybe crashes into that building, the Bender Zone.
Oh, boy.
Those are the guys that own DC 101 that we were never allowed to talk about.
Right.
The Benders. You know, Let me just say something, as long as you're on the topic, Robin. Remember how the Benders used to give to charities? And, like, there were big charitable people, and we'd always hear about some big charity function they were going to?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, pals, what would have been so wrong with giving me a couple of dollars and Robin a couple of dollars to work there?
Yeah, could that have been so bad?
Yeah, I mean, I had a wife, and she was pregnant and stuff. I mean, I think that would have been a decent thing to do. I was bringing you in a couple of million dollars a year. I think it would have been a decent thing to do to give me some charity. I was working for you. You guys with the charity really kill me. How about people paying people a decent salary to work for you?
Yeah, you're millionaires.
Yeah, you're multimillionaires. You couldn't possibly care either way.
It couldn't have hurt. You wouldn't have noticed.
No, but you got to toe the bottom line, man. You got to make sure, you know, pay all the money to Goff. Make sure he gets it.
Yeah, because he's the genius that brings in the rating.
Yeah, he's some genius, all right. We'll see what a genius he is. We'll see. You know what, Benders? Give him $5 million to give away on DC-101. We're still going to beat him. Give him $10 million. Give him money to hire a newsman.
I don't know how I was on the subject, but I was talking about the space shuttle. But anyway, the astronauts have been very lucky because Robin Williams consented to give them wake-up calls practically every day of this mission.
What is Robin Williams doing in New York now? What is he? He's doing some Broadway play?
Yeah, he and Steve Martin are rehearsing Waiting for Godot.
Screw those two guys, man.
Their contribution to stage acting has been to grow beards.
Yeah. No, the point is that you know what they're doing. They're doing a play for fun. It's a good, for anybody who's a real actor who like is busting their hump coming up, it's like a real slap in the face when Robin Williams comes to play act with Steve Martin in a play for just a couple of weeks.
This will be one of those instances where you go to Broadway and you won't be able to hear the actors because they're not stage trained.
Yeah, and also they'll be goofing and ad-libbing and it'll just, I just can't stand those two guys.
Yeah.
All right, anyway, here's Robin Williams waking up the astronauts.
Hi, yeah. Pinky. It's me, to Claremont Men's College while you were going to Harvey Mudd.
Hey, this will be Robin Williams ad-libbing. No one will know what he's talking about, and everyone will call him a genius. An ad-lib genius. Regular genius with a mustache. He gets on for 5 minutes in a movie, ad-libs for 5 minutes, he's up for an Oscar nomination. We've been ad-libbing for 10 years here, doing pretty well at it. Nobody even gives me a Billboard award.
Here's a song going out to all those Pitzer girls.
Who?
Pitzer girls. Something about this mud college he's talking about with some astronaut out there.
It's a personal message.
Yeah.
I see, but nobody knows what he's talking about. But it's genius. Absolutely genius. This is incredible. He's ad-libbing. Isn't that homosexual high school?
That's Harvey Milk.
Oh, Harvey Milk. Harvey Mudd, isn't he the guy on Star Trek who was trading in women and those gelatin pills?
What? That might have been.
Oh, that was Harry Mudd.
Harry.
Yeah. Harry Mudd, right. Robin Williams is a real genius. You know what he is, actually? I'm going to call a spade a spade. He's a mixed-up, wife-dumping...
Manny humping
guy who just who hit it lucky. The nanu.
Yeah.
I guess I'm bitter or something.
Well, listen to this. Isn't that funny?
It's just that I never hear this guy being funny. I mean, he's incredibly rapid with his thoughts and everything, but the thoughts don't make any sense. Even his HBO special, they just don't make any sense. I don't get it. There's no content here. Everybody's listening to this going, this is hysterical. That was a funny line, eating breakfast from a toothpaste.
Good morning, Houston. There's not a dry eye in the house.
And they get their cute little thing back.
Yeah, the astronauts.